aside. I'm leaving my doubts behind. I'm giving my hopes and dreams to you, Jesus. I'm reaching my hands to yours, believing there's so much more, knowing that all you have in store for me is good. It's good. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm trusting in what you say. Today is the day. Today is the day. I will stand up on your truth.
I will stand up on your truth.
And all my days I'll live for you.
And all my days I'll live for you.
I will stand up on your truth.
I will stand up on your truth.
And all my days I'll live for you.
Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Today is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. And I won't worry about tomorrow. I'm giving you my fears and sorrows. Where you lead me, I will follow. Trusting in what
today is the day. One more time. Today is the day. Okay, that was different.
Got to pay the internet bill.
Yeah, really.
Be seated, please. Today is the day. Bill tests our memory. Do what?
There's a gavel for you.
Oh. I could use that.
Somebody left that here yesterday.
Oh. I don't know who. Somebody left a hammer here at work day yesterday?
In the morning.
It's here. Hey.
Is that our hammer?
All over the land.
Okay.
Are y'all through? This is the weirdest thing watching them sometimes. The interactions are back and forth. And the look on your face when Teresa vanished was hysterical. He saw you coming. He was reaching for the mic. He turned around and you were gone because you went through the door. Anyway, happy Father's Day, guys. We looking forward to a good day. Actually, action for alert today of my family running off on me because it's a, now they've been in town for since Wednesday and Thursday, and we've had a great time with them, and we're just exhausted. But aside from that, we're doing well. I want to thank everybody that had a hand in yesterday. We had a really good work day up here. The Cub Scout guys came and they cleaned out around the stage. We've always had a little path just about as wide as the lawnmower, but now it's about two or three times that wide around so we can get around back there, cut the weeds back. Had an army out there working on the old shed. I don't know if you've ever paid much attention to it, but the siding was really good down to about a foot off the ground, and then it sort of curled and rotted away. So pulled off all the old siding, put on new. The guys did a great job. Appreciate it. Mike, and I'm going to apologize publicly because the bulletin says Mark Boynowski, but it's Mike Boynowski. I know that. We'll blame autocorrect. But anyway, Mike headed that up and measured and figured out everything we needed and got the guys here. Appreciate you guys doing that. And then Ken and Bill attacked all the overhang, all the growth out here on the parking lot down on the highway side, down to the light post. We got to get the rest of it. But anyway, there's always stuff to do. But I appreciate everybody that came out yesterday. It was a really good work day. So, new week, new stuff to do, and we'll just turn it over to the Lord. Let's pray together. Father, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for these that have gathered in your church. We thank you for Father's Day, Father. And I know it's nothing biblical or all that special, but it's just a day we set aside to think about our dads, and we thank you for that, the opportunity to do that. We do ask your blessings on all the guys of this church. Thank you for the great work yesterday that went on. And we thank you, Father, for what's going on in the hearts and minds of our people here. And we're feeling you. We know you're there. We know you love us. And we know you're leading us. And we thank you for that. Father, bless our church today. Bless our worship service. Be with those that are unable to be here with some illness and different things going on. And, Father, just use this time to draw us closer to you. In Jesus' name, amen. By the way, for Father's Day, out on the little round table where you come in, there's several gifts. Barb provided some candy, and Donna provided some candy, and Cindy Lee provided something practical. There's like some tape measures and little screwdrivers and things. So, guys, help yourself to all of that. And remember, if you got home without a hammer, this might be yours. Senor?
All right, let's stand and continue with our time of worship with "To God Be the Glory."
It is
Hit the drum over there, kid. And unlike our internet collection, Christ has made us flawless.
There's got to be more than going back and forth from doing right to doing wrong. We were taught that's who we are. Come on, get in line right behind you along with everybody. Thinking there's worth in what you do. Live like a hero who takes the stage when we're on the edge of our seats saying it's too late. Simply can't believe that this unconditional kind of love would be enough to take a filthy wretch like this, wrap him up in righteousness. That's exactly what he did. No matter the bumps, no matter the losers, no matter the scars, still the truth is the cross has paid. The cross has paid.
That was hard this morning. Bountiful Blessings is up and running on Saturday. And Teresa, did you say you want to share something?
Just so thank you. Thank you for
I thought that's what you waved, but then
yeah,
you looked
like,
at me
like... Anyway, the point is, thank you for all the donations of the deodorant adult toothpaste. I really, really appreciate it. And Thursday night, the Bountiful Blessings volunteers at 6 p.m. We are going to do a much-needed pitching of expired things and getting a good count inventory. So that's all I have. Thank you. Oh, and Fall Fest is coming. And if you have one of those clicker counter things that golf people use, I really need one. Thank you.
I'm sure between now and October we can find one, or September, whatever the thing is.
I don't want to walk around.
Hey, I saw a lady at Hershey the other day that had one. Maybe we can nab hers. Okay, well, Bountiful Blessings. That was the only other thing I was going to share. You'll find in your bulletin day a little Father's Day, little funny papers. Barb makes these available, and sometimes they're in the bulletin, sometimes they're just on the table. The one thing that I just laughed out loud this morning, I was looking at this, talking about parenting, the good news, I smile because they're my children. I laugh because there's nothing they can do about it. I like that. Anyway, again, my thanks to all you guys that showed up yesterday and did a lot of work around here, and we appreciate all of it. Good week. We're back up Tuesday Bible study, and then we'll be back around. Saturday's Bountiful, and then we're back here on Sunday. So for Sunday school at 9:30. Yes, thank you, Scott. There's a voice that always reminds me about Sunday school. Anyway, we're glad you're here this morning, and look forward to just continuing one more song, and then we'll get into our message today.
Okay. All right. Let's stand, and as Richard said, we will sing one more song before he brings today's message. We're going to sing Mighty to Save.
Okay, good. I'm glad.
I get you. That'd be cool.
Because that's about the only way I could play that, Scott. All right. We'll let Teresa gather up everybody. All right, now remember, Teresa, you have a room full of children. Don't just cater to Owen. All right, aside from my email Friday, show of hands, who is familiar with the name Mephibosheth prior to my email? A couple of you. All right, of those who say yeah, how many of you know anything about him? Less. Cool. All right. Well, I want to tell you the story of Mephibosheth this morning. It's a wonderful story about King David and his loyalty, but more than that, it's a wonderful story depicting the very thing we talked about last week, and that is the love of God that he has for us. So we're going to be in 2 Samuel chapter 9. That's where I want you to turn. We'll get there in a minute. I'm going to read one other scripture before we get there, but that's okay. You just get there and hang out. I think most of us know the story in the Old Testament about Saul's dislike for David. Saul was the first king of Israel. He was anointed by Samuel. Samuel was the last of the biblical judges, following in footsteps of people like Samson and Gideon and Deborah. These were godly, hand-picked leaders in those early days when they were settling the land. And in Samuel's day, the people decided that they wanted to change things up. And instead of having judges rule over them, they wanted to have a king. And so Samuel, I love this story, but Samuel comes to God and he's all forlorn. He says, they've rejected me and they want a king like everybody else. And God says, nah, just I'm paraphrasing God here, but he says, basically, Samuel, cool your jets. It's not you they're rejecting, it's me they're rejecting. So they want a king, give him a king and go get Saul. He'll be the guy. He'll take care of things. Except Saul has his share of problems as king. Primarily, Saul has ultimately proved to be an egotistical old boy who's decided that his way and his decisions are better than anybody else's, including God's. And the final blow was the fact that Saul was asked to kill a guy named Agag. Agag was the king of the Amalekites. Saul was to kill him and all of his possessions, and that included all of his livestock. Well, they went to battle, they killed a lot of people, they destroyed a lot of stuff, but they let Agag live, bringing him back as prisoner, and they kept the livestock for himself and his men. You know, why waste a good cow? So when confronted by Samuel for not fully obeying, and this is the other passage I want to read to you, here's Saul's response. But I did obey the Lord, Saul said. I went on the mission the Lord assigned me. I completely destroyed the Amalekites and brought back Agag, their king. The soldiers took sheep and cattle from the plunder, the best of what was devoted to God, in order to sacrifice them to the Lord your God at Gilgal. This was his excuse. Yeah, I know. We were told to kill all the cattle, but we brought them back because we're going to give them to God. It's for the Lord. It seems like I've heard that repeated many a time down through the years. But Samuel has one of the best responses for Saul in this moment. And Samuel says very simply, to obey is better than to sacrifice. To obey is better than sacrifice. Don't talk about religion. Do what I asked you to do. And see, that actually becomes a rather contemporary problem, because sometimes we get caught up in actions of our own understanding sometimes and our own interpretations that we know what this means, and we forget simple obedience to God. But in this case, because of Saul's disobedience, he's rejected as king. In fact, Scripture tells us that the Lord's Spirit is taken from him, and the calling and the Spirit and the anointing will fall on the young shepherd boy named David. Now, this is not an overnight process. You know, when David is first on the scene, when he kills Goliath, he's just a kid, not old enough to join the army. He's 30 when he becomes king. So there's this 13, 14, 15-year window when David is called to be king but not serving as king. When Saul grows bad and more paranoid about David and even attempts to kill him. So it's in this expansive window of time that young David and King Saul's son named Jonathan become friends. And Jonathan helps protect David from his father Saul. And when the Old Testament pages turn from 1 Samuel to 2 Samuel, we find at this point both Saul and Jonathan are dead, having died in battle. And now, with the book of 2 Samuel, David becomes the king. And in these opening chapters of 2 Samuel, you see David growing in power and strength. He's defeated the Philistines. He's conquered Jerusalem. He sets up Jerusalem as their religious center, brings the Ark of the Covenant there, sets up the Tent of Meeting. And in 2 Samuel 7:1, we're told that the Lord had given David rest from all his enemies. And because David's a good guy who wants to be honorable and loyal and do good things, we come to the narrative here in chapter 9 that we want to look at. So let's start with verse 1. 2 Samuel chapter 9, verse 1. David, the king, asks, "Is there anyone still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake?" Now, I want you to understand that before we get a little deeper into this chapter. Understand that verse. He wants to honor any of Saul's descendants who may still be around. He doesn't know that there are any. But he wants to do this, and he wants to do this not for Saul's sake, but because of the friendship that Jonathan had given him. And so, that's his question in verse 1. Is there anyone still around from the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness? The story goes on, verse 2. Now there was a servant of Saul's household named Ziba. They summoned him to appear before David, and the king said to him, "Are you Ziba?" "At your service," he replied. The king asked, "Is there no one still alive from the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness?" Ziba answered the king, "There is still a son of Jonathan. He is lame in both feet." "Where is he?" the king asked. Ziba said, "He is at the house of Machir, son of Amiel, in a town called Lodabar." So King David had him brought from Lodabar, from the house of Machir, son of Amiel. When Mephibosheth, son of Jonathan, the son of Saul, came to David, he bowed down to pay him honor. David said, "Mephibosheth, at your service," he replied. "Don't be afraid," David said to him, "for I will surely show you kindness for the sake of your father Jonathan. I will restore to you all the land that belonged to your grandfather Saul, and you will always eat at my table." And verse 8 says, Mephibosheth bowed down and said, "What is your servant that you should notice a dead dog like me?" I think it's safe to assume that when Mephibosheth is summoned to appear in David's palace, that there was some formidable fear on his part. After all, King David and his grandfather were enemies. That was well known. And although a lot of Saul's family had died in battle, Jonathan included, Jonathan's brothers included, David was free from that threat. But if you're the last survivor, and you had a crummy life anyway, being lame in both feet, your grandfather's enemies may just be your enemies. And when they summon you, well, I don't think that's going to instill a whole lot of excitement on your part. More fear than anything. And it wasn't uncommon in those days. It wasn't a practice for the Jews, but it wasn't uncommon with other peoples to kill off the remaining family of your political enemies. Technically, Mephibosheth was the rightful heir to the throne. So yeah, fear was real. Now, what Mephibosheth couldn't have known was David's heart. He didn't realize the kindness. He didn't realize the depth of the relationship that David had with his father, Jonathan. So when he came, surely he came fearfully, but he also came ultimately to hear good news. Not death, but life. Not nothing, but everything. Not cruelty, but care. Let's read the rest of the chapter. Verse 9. Then the king summoned Ziba, Saul's steward, and said to him, "I've given your master's grandson everything that belonged to Saul and his family. You and your sons and your servants are to farm the land for him, bring in the crops so that your master's grandson may be provided for. And Mephibosheth, grandson of your master, will always eat at my table." Now Ziba had 15 sons and 20 servants. Then Ziba said to the king, "Your servant will do whatever my lord the king commands his servant to do." So Mephibosheth ate at David's table like one of the king's sons. Mephibosheth had a young son named Micah, and all the members of Ziba's household were servants of Mephibosheth. And Mephibosheth lived in Jerusalem because he always ate at the king's table. And again, there's the reminder that he was lame in both feet. Now, I'm going to tell you, honestly, because I know how we are, for us, this is a story that might just get passed over in our mindset of, I'm trying to read through the Old Testament, I got to get through the Old Testament, and this is just one chapter, and I can't even pronounce the guy's name. So we're just going to read it and get through it. But it is so much more than that, because it's actually an amazing story and an amazing portrayal of God's love for us. In a very real sense, we are Mephibosheth. And for this morning's sake, we're going to allow David's love and concern to be God's love and concern for us. Let me show you what I mean. We are Mephibosheth. We are weak. We are broken. We are fearful. That's how a lot of people see themselves today. That's why addictions are so prevalent. That's why judgment and dislike of other people is so prevalent. The less I like myself, the less I'm going to like everybody else around me. And if in that low feeling of myself, someone suggests that God cares about me, well, I might ignore that, or I might mock that. Now, if I happen to be a believer in God and I have this low self-worth, okay, I'm not going to be on the front lines of seeking God's will. If I'm fearful of what God might ask of me, I'm not going to be the biggest prayer warrior in town. I'm not going to be the biggest Bible reader. Oh, I'll come to church, but only out of habit. I'll own a Bible, but I'm not going to read it. And I'll pray over my meals. But to really come before God, I don't really want to do that. Not if I can help it. And frankly, if I'm Mephibosheth, and I'm lame, and I may be the last guy in the line of my family, I don't really want to go before the king. And if I go, I'm going to go fearfully. Let me show you a couple things about Mephibosheth's condition that speak to his fear. Here's our introduction to him. Just turn back a couple pages to chapter 4. 2 Samuel chapter 4, and it's just one verse. It's verse 4. But here's where we meet the guy. 2 Samuel chapter 4, verse 4. It says, Jonathan, son of Saul, had a son who was lame in both feet. He was 5 years old when the news came about Saul and Jonathan from Jezreel. That is when Saul and Jonathan were killed in battle. That's the news. His nurse, Mephibosheth's nurse, picked him up and fled, but as she hurried to leave, he fell and became disabled. And his name was Mephibosheth. That's our introduction to him. There he is. And what's going on there is a lot of warfare, and Saul's gone, and Jonathan's gone, and other men who led the armies and wanted to assume the throne, they were being murdered. And so in this time of terror, the nurse who's caring for little Mephibosheth gathers him up and tries to get out of there and drops him, falls. Maybe his feet, his ankles, his legs, we don't really know, but they were so damaged beyond their ability to repair anything. And so that's how his life changes. At 5 years old, he's heir to the throne to a guy with nothing. And where does she go? They go to a town called Lodabar. We know that because that's in the original narrative that we read in chapter 9. We know that's where they find him. The old servant of Saul, Ziba, he says that Jonathan's son's in Lodabar. Lodabar is an interesting word. The word debar in Hebrew means a thing or a word. But the prefix lo in Hebrew negates the word. Lo means no. So the little village that they were in is really called no thing, no word. It was literally nothing town. Nowhere. You ever been there? I have. Well, that's where he is. And it actually came to be known as no pasture. It was good for nothing. So imagine being the descendant of King Saul, possibly the only one left, having worthless feet, knowing that you'll never be king, because David already is, knowing that people are trying to kill off your family, knowing that you've lived your life in a place called nothing. That's Mephibosheth's mindset. And that's why his first words to David are, why should you notice a dead dog like me? Again, let me tell you something. Christians, our world is full of people with that same mindset. Our world is full of people who have such a low view of themselves. No hope, no future, no purpose. All they can see is their pain, their problems, and their worthlessness. I read a news story, this was several years ago, many years ago, actually it was right after 9/11, and it was explaining why young Islamic men were so easily persuaded to be terrorists. And in part, in a very real part, it's because in countries like Saudi Arabia, that you have this upper echelon of incredibly wealthy, incredibly powerful people, and it's all based in oil, and it's a very tiny minority of the country. And then there's everybody else, and there's just not enough good
oil field jobs, and there's just not enough servant jobs to the royal family to go around. And you have this vast majority of young men who have no hope, no life. And so this promise of grandeur and eternity seems better than reality. And the truth is, that situation is spreading around the world. The more wealth gets into a rapidly shrinking group of people who have all the money and all the power, everybody else feels left behind. And the spirit of worthlessness grows in the human heart around the globe, even in our country. Mephibosheth is symbolic of a great many people in our world. And the personal negativism and that self-loathing actually plays a significant role in how people see God. If I don't see myself as having an ounce of worth, I don't care that you tell me that God cares for me, because I don't think he does. So when Mephibosheth says to David, "Why would you notice a dead dog like me?" he represents a whole lot of people's feeling toward God, toward faith, toward the thought that God would care for them. And so they're fearful, and if possible, they stay away from church, and they avoid it altogether. They avoid God. They wallow in their perception of worthlessness. And that's Mephibosheth, the symbol of way too many people today. Well, let's flip the story, and let's look at this from David's side now. From the side of love, from the side of loyalty. Go back to his question in chapter 9, verse 1. Is there anyone still left of the house of Saul to whom I can show kindness for Jonathan's sake? Remember, Saul wanted David dead. His men were all too eager to help. But with Saul's, but the one man, Saul's son Jonathan, he was willing to help David. You see, once young David became the hero for killing Goliath, Saul took him in the house, befriended him. But once Saul sinned and Samuel told that he would leave his position as king, David became the enemy. And in all that window of time, David and Jonathan became friends, bound by a deep appreciation for one another. 1 Kings, let me just read this to you. You don't need to look this up. And actually, it's 1 Samuel. But it's 1 Samuel 19. Jonathan speaks of David to Saul on David's behalf. He said, "Saul told his son Jonathan and all the attendants to kill David. But Jonathan had taken a great liking to David and warned him, 'My father Saul is looking for a chance to kill you. Be on your guard tomorrow morning. Go into hiding and stay there. I'll go out and stand with my father in the field where you are. I'll speak to him about you and will tell you what I find out.' Jonathan spoke well of David to Saul, his father, and said to him, 'Let not the king do wrong to his servant David, for he has not wronged you, and what he has done has benefited you greatly. He took his life in his hands when he killed the Philistine. The Lord won a great victory for all Israel, and you saw it and were glad. Why then would you do wrong to an innocent man like David by killing him for no reason?'" A little bit later in 1 Samuel 23, we find this. While David was at Horesh in the desert of Ziph, he learned that Saul had come out to take his life. And Saul's son Jonathan went to David at Horesh and helped him find strength in God. "Don't be afraid," he said. "My father Saul will not lay a hand on you. You'll be king over Israel, and I will be second to you. Even my father Saul knows this." The two of them made a covenant before the Lord. Then Jonathan went home, but David remained at Horesh. So you see this friendship developing. And this loyalty between them. David, of course, lives to become king and do great things because Jonathan stood between his friend David and his father Saul. Jonathan loses his life in battle. Saul's gone. Many of Saul's family is gone. But David, loyal to the memory of his son, his friend Jonathan, loyal to his commitment to protect him, wants to show kindness to somebody in that family on behalf of Jonathan, on behalf of all that Jonathan did for him. Now, I'm going to tell you, honestly, there's a certain contradiction in my message this morning. God's not loyal to us because we've been so loyal to him. God doesn't love us because we first loved him. In fact, it's just the opposite in Scripture. 1 John 4:19 tells us that we love because he first loved us. And the human relationship, the bond between these two guys, the best we can read is that it was a wonderful mutual development between two guys who just became really close. Now, I don't know about you all. I've had good friends for a season. You know, there were childhood friends. There were teen year friends. I've had friends, close friends in different churches and different times in my adult life. And frankly, outside of my brother and one cousin, there's been no lifelong friend. I mean, Teresa came along, you know, when we were both in our teens, but no lifelong friend from early on. And I'm kind of jealous of people who have that in their life, and I know a few, and I think it's really neat. But that's what we have here in David and Jonathan, this lifelong friendship. This, and the important observation here is that even with Jonathan gone, even with the history between David and Saul, David's heart is such that he desires to be loyal and kind and to extend that friendship with Jonathan forward in his life. So David's love for Jonathan falls forward to Mephibosheth. And it's in that forward motion that we find the comparison to God's love. I came across a quote this week. This was in a blog posting by somebody at Grand Canyon University named Lily Cooper. But it reflected a lot of the thought that I had been reading and that I was thinking. But the author said that this relationship between David and Mephibosheth shows the relationship we have with God. Quote, "We are weak and broken, and yet God has a place for us at his table. Regardless of our flaws and shortcomings, he loves us so much and wants us to get to know him." And that's David toward Mephibosheth. Did David even know he existed? I would assume at some point he knew that Jonathan had a son, but that son disappears when he's 5 years old. And with all of the commotion, with all the infighting in Israel, with all the infighting in Saul's family, with all the battles with the Philistines, it would have been very easy to assume that the boy had died. And I think that's reflected in David's question, in seeking survivors. He doesn't know that he exists. But whether he knew of him or not, whether there were other survivors or not, David's heart remains the same. Because of his love and his loyalty toward an old friend, if someone's out there, I want to care for him. And to me, I'm going to tell you this, the coolest thing about finding Mephibosheth existed and that he survived all the mess, and then finding out about his condition with his feet, David still wanted to care for him. Now, I know I'm a little cynical at times, but I've known enough people, and I know how I am sometimes, that I'm thinking that David could have easily said when he found out, he's lame, he has problems, maybe we don't want to take all that on, leave him where he is, send him a check, and we'll go from there, you know? Send him a couple gold coins and a couple cows. And we won't have to worry about him that way. But he'll know we were thinking about him. Thoughts and prayers, right? So why bring his problems into our house? But that's not David. And David's love overrode any hesitation to the problems. And no matter the depth of the disability, no matter the difficulty that might bring to his own house, Mephibosheth is to dine at his table every night, says David. We had a couple in our church in Missouri. He was the local game warden. And they already had two boys, two healthy little guys, but they adopted a third boy. And it's been too many years, and I don't remember his condition exactly, but he was severely disabled. I never saw him out of his little wheelchair. But remember, he was adopted. They made the choice to take this little guy in to their family and care for him with their own kids. That's what David does with Mephibosheth. And he does it because of this loyalty to an old friend. He does it because his heart is patterned after God's heart. It was a heart of kindness and love and mercy and care. And I'm going to tell you something. It's the absolute truth in this message this morning. We may be like Mephibosheth, and we may be weak, lame, mentally in Lodabar, just nowhere. We may be fearful of God and not wanting a relationship. We may separate ourselves from God because we don't really understand that he cares for us and that he can do things for us and that he strongly desires to bless us. And we may be separated from all that blessing by our own self-will. But the King, in fact, the King of Kings, wants us with him. And hey, he may not immediately take away our weaknesses and our disabilities. He may not instantly restore you to a place of self-confidence and self-worth, but he gives you a place to come and a table to sit at and a place to heal. That's what our God does for us. He gives us a sense of value the longer we sit at his table. And the pains of life and the sting of worthlessness in time fade away and become replaced by a sense of value, a sense of worth, a sense of blessing, a sense of being a child of the King. And it's not because of us. It's because of God. It's not because we're special, because we're not. It's truly because he first loved us, for God so loved the world. All right, I want you to jump forward to Matthew chapter 9, and we're going to wrap up with this real quick. But I want you to see this sense of sitting at the Lord's table with a great little story that involves Jesus. Matthew chapter 9, and we're going to start with verse 9. And here's what Matthew writes for us. As Jesus went on from there, he saw a man named Matthew, also known as Levi. He saw a man named Matthew sitting at the tax collector's booth. "Follow me," he told him, and Matthew got up and followed him. While Jesus was having dinner at Matthew's house, many tax collectors and sinners came and ate with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they asked his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" See, the Pharisees' question was very much a question of why. Why is Jesus eating with a bunch of worthless, lame losers? Because that's all they saw. But Jesus heard their inquiry. Cuts it off. Verse 12. On hearing this, Jesus said, "It's not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. But go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice, for I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." Mephibosheth was not righteous. His pedigree as a grandson of Saul meant little to nothing. Saul went down in flames. So what if you're the grandson of that guy? His worthless feet made him that much more worthless in their culture. Lodabar was the perfect place for him. He was nothing. But David saw differently. David saw his worth. David saw his value. Mephibosheth's value wasn't in his pedigree or in his broken feet. His value to David was in his father, Jonathan. And so is our value. But not because of Jonathan, but because of Jesus, who comes to call all of us sinners, all of us broken, all of us worthless, valueless, lame people. He calls us to a meal at his table. And Jesus desires mercy, not sacrifice. What was it Samuel said to Saul way back? To obey is better than to sacrifice. See, church, we got to change our mindset. We got to get out of this thought that showing up here and owning a Bible and asking God to bless our meals is enough. Yeah, we may be like Mephibosheth, but the truth is we're called to be like David. We're called to be an example of Jesus. But there's a whole lot of hurting people in our world today. And instead of adding to their hurt, the church needs to be the place that extends the love of God to them. That's us, the heart of David, the heart of Jesus, all the gift of God. Don't be the Pharisees in the story in Matthew who see everybody out there that they don't like as losers. Be like Jesus who sees the potential in all of us. After all, Matthew wrote the gospel that we read the story. Be like David and show kindness. Be like Jesus who loves us. Now to do it, you got to know it. But knowing it is simple. We have a manual. We have folks around us who do it. We just need to learn. We need to love and give into Christ and accept him and go forward from there, growing in his word and his work. But that's who we are. Church. That's who we are. And that's what we need to act like. And there's a whole lot of churches that simply don't do it. We got a job. Kind of stand up straight and do it. And all that stuff we've talked about since Easter, all those building blocks of our faith are a part of it. What were the first three? See Jesus, learn Jesus, do Jesus. Simple. Simple. Let's pray together. Father, thank you for this morning. Thank you for this message. I thank you. This great tiny little piece of a story, the care that David showed just to honor his friend Jonathan, but to bring this guy in and to care for him and to restore all that was his family's, and to give him cattle and land and servants. Father, we may not be able to do that for everybody, but we sure can show off your love. And where we can meet a need with a roll of paper towels, we can do it. Where we can provide diapers and some cans of food, amen. But Father, more than that, we need to be a people that show your love, your salvation, and your grace, and your mercy. Father, help us to be those people. In Jesus' name, amen, amen. All right, we're going to sing one final song here, and as we do, I'm going to offer an invitation, and the invitation is to come and pray with me. If you have something going on that you need to pray about, if you want to come join with us in this church, if you want to come and commit to a ministry, if you want to come and accept Jesus for the very first time, maybe you've never done that, this is the invitation. This is your time to do that. Honor God in what you do. Let's stand together. We'll sing Change My Heart, O God. Short little prayer that we can sing in our heart and say all day long. Change my heart, oh God, may I be like you. Thank you all for coming out. I hope you've been blessed today for being here, and we look for you at different opportunities through the week. Again, thanks to everybody that showed up yesterday and helped out. Just a wonderful work day. Appreciate all that's going on in our church.
Well, Pam's got something to celebrate.
Okay.
Oh. Very good. Congratulations. All right. Huh? Mike has a birthday on the 20th.
Wow. Ah. Almost escaped, Mike.
Yeah, it was close. That was close.
You almost escaped.
Do your thing.
Let's do it.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Mike. Happy birthday to you.
Let's pray together. Father, we do thank you for this morning. Thank you for this church family. We just thank you, Father, for the friendship that we feel in here and the heart that we have. Just pray, Father, that we continue to seek and find ways that we can open those doors of our hearts to others, to include them, to bring them into a life-saving relationship with you. Father, bless us as we minister in this community. Thank you for this community. Let us do our thing in Jesus' name.